Hey, Wonder Hussy here, out in the middle of nowhere in the beautiful Spring Mountains, just outside Las Vegas, about to check out this creepy, old, abandoned A-frame cabin. I mean, this thing is way out here in the middle of nowhere. You can see there's my rig, which barely made it up this really rough, bumpy road. From Cottonwood Valley, that's where we came up. And you might be able to see in the distance, it's kind of a hazy day. You can see Vegas actually, just over that riser. Let me zoom in. You can see all the nastiness going on in town right now. But where we are, we're up in the, well, kind of the foothills of the Spring Mountains. Apologies for the sun, I know it's right there, but it's a lot prettier back here. Now, unfortunately, this cabin has definitely seen better days. I don't know anything about the history of this cabin. Probably some guy living up here with a little mining operation or something. But looks like the porch is totally collapsed. So to even get inside it, we're gonna have to climb up this board that somebody has so thoughtfully laid out like a walkway. Sturdy. Uh-oh, and to get to the door, we're gonna have to hop onto this barrel full of concrete, which is, by the way, being used as a foundation to prop up the whole dang cabin. Yikes. Oh gosh, and then we're gonna have to step across to get in there. I don't know how we're gonna do it. Yikes. Ugh. We made it. Boy, that was gnarly, but we made it up into this cabin, and you can see it's just a big one-room A-frame cabin with a loft up top. Looks like they had a wood-burning stove there. And gosh, it must have been super cozy up here back in the day. Like a little ski chalet overlooking, God, the whole Vegas Valley. There's that same view that we were just looking back down at right out the front door. But it must have been real cozy in here. It looks like there was probably a bathroom back in here. It's completely destroyed now. I don't know if it was plumbed or what, but... Then they just had one big room with, well, questionable insulation. And then looks like a loft up here. Let's see, how's this ladder? Ooh, it's rickety, I don't know. Should I climb it? There's nothing up there anyways, so I don't really see the point in risking my neck, A, and in wasting more time, because... I'm actually up here on a mission. I didn't just come up here to explore this cabin. I came here to hike to a really interesting historical site that I've been wanting to check out for a long time. Okay, for this adventure, we're gonna go all the way back in time to January 16th, 1942, when an airplane carrying a famous movie star crashed on the mountainside right here behind me. That's Mount Potosi behind me. I'm not sure you can see. There's a cell phone tower at the very tippy top. It's called Mount Potosi. And oh gosh, about 3/4 of the way up that slope, there was a terrible plane crash back in January of 1942. So the story is actually really interesting. So back in 1942, obviously the United States was right in the middle of World War II, and there was this famous actress named Carol Lombard, really pretty blonde. I guess she was known for being in like screwball comedies. Popular actress of the day, and she was doing her part to support the war effort by, I think she was doing like USO tours, entertaining the troops. So she was doing some kind of cross-country promotional tour in the United States. But meanwhile, she was married to another famous actor, Clark Gable, okay? The Clark Gable from Gone with the Wind. Everybody knows Clark Gable. Well, she was married to him. They were probably like the Brad Pitt and Angelina Jolie of their day. Or maybe they were more like the Brad Pitt and Jennifer Aniston of their day. Because guess what? Carol Lombard started hearing rumors that Clark Gable was fooling around behind her back with another beautiful actress by the name of Lana Turner. You know Lana Turner, the sweater girl? She really filled out a sweater. Well, she was also 10 years younger than Carol Lombard, and Clark Gable apparently was sniffing around looking for a younger model. Well, I guess Carol Lombard caught wind of this while she was on her USO tour, and when the tour wrapped up, she was in a hurry to get back to Los Angeles and confront Clark Gable and get to the bottom of what was going on. She wanted to find out if her man was messing around on her. So back then, to fly cross country was a much bigger deal than it is now. I mean, in the 40s, they had airplanes and commercial airplanes, and it wasn't that uncommon to fly commercially. But it wasn't like today where you can fly from New York to LA in 4 or 5 hours. I read online that it took something like 17 hours. These airlines would advertise coast to coast in 17 hours. Boy, what a deal. But apparently back then they had to fly every few hundred miles. They had to stop and refuel. So I think the flight that Carol Lombard was in originated in New York, and then it flew to Newark, and then it flew to, gosh, I don't remember, Ohio. And from Ohio, it flew to Kansas. I don't know. I made like 5, 6, 7 stops all along the way across the USA. And by the time it got here to Las Vegas, they landed at Nellis Air Force Base to refuel, and I think it was about 7 o'clock in the evening when they took off from Las Vegas to continue on to their final destination, Los Angeles. Now, interestingly, I also read online that I think they stopped in Albuquerque right before Nellis. The last stop before they got here to Vegas was Albuquerque, and the weather was really bad in Albuquerque, and they tried to get a... I guess they asked the civilian passengers, I don't know if they asked or forced some of the civilian passengers or all the civilian passengers on board this jet to get off because there was some kind of, some division of Army Air Force guys that needed to fly. But Carol Lombard supposedly convinced them. Well, I read two accounts. Either she said, "No one's making me get off this plane. I'm a star." That's one way I heard it put. Another way I heard it put was, she convinced him that she also was part of the war effort and she deserved to be on the plane just as much as these Army guys. Whatever the case, they let Carol Lombard and her mother and everyone else in her party stay on the aircraft. So it went from Albuquerque to Nellis, landed and refueled at Nellis Air Force Base, which is just back down there in the valley, and then it took off from there headed for Los Angeles. Well, it should have been an easy flight. It was supposedly a clear night here. The weather was fine here. No moon out, so it was dark, but... there's a lot of controversy surrounding what happened, but whatever happened, the plane ended up going down, crashing right into the side of this cliff in the pitch black, freezing cold of a January night. Now, when I say there's some conspiracies about what happened, gosh, I read online there was theories about what could have caused this plane to go down because it was clear weather and the pilot was a seasoned pilot. He'd been doing it for a while. So people thought like, oh, maybe it was shot down by the Nazis because World War II, you know, or the, I don't know, the Russians, whatever. There's all kind of weird conspiracy theories. Maybe the pilot just got confused. I read that he was 7 miles off course. Another theory I read was, well, it was dark and there was a lot of reflection on the windows of the aircraft from the lights on the instrument panel. Maybe it blinded the pilot, but gee, you think that would have been the case in all the other places he'd stopped and flown from. So I'm not sure what would have caused him to crash into this mountain. The crash site is around 7,800 feet. And well, I'm here today hiking with my friend Larry. And Larry said that back then, aircraft didn't fly at as high of altitude as they do today. So back then, it wouldn't have been unusual for a commercial plane to be cruising at, 7,000-8,000 feet. So yeah, it ran right into the side of this mountain. It was terrible. Now, because the side of this mountain is so rugged, I mean, this terrain is really rugged. And I can speak to that personally. I just, even driving up here to this trailhead was gnarly. I mean, I'm in my Toyota 4Runner and I've got good tires and a lift and everything, but it was still like, we were crawling along, but we made it up here just fine. I would definitely recommend thinking twice about driving this road though, if you don't have a serious off-road vehicle. But imagine how hard it must have been for the rescue effort to get up here. And gosh, try to help any survivors. I mean, it was dark of night. There was no moon. It was freezing cold winter. And this terrain is just crazy rugged. I can't imagine how difficult this rescue operation must have been. I think there's actually a book about the rescue effort. And it would be really interesting to read because apparently the police or whoever was investigating the crash, I think it was investigated by the FBI because of the nature of the people on board. They ended up having to go up into Red Rock Canyon, into Bonnie Springs, and get some old cowboys or miners or guys that were familiar with the terrain, and they came out here on horseback. That was the only way to get out here, to try and help any survivors, which I don't think there were any survivors. I'm pretty sure, I think there was 22 people on board. Well, they all died in the crash. Well, meanwhile, while the search was going on, I guess word got back to Clark Gable in Hollywood, where he's probably in Lana Turner's bed, like, There's been a terrible plane crash, and your wife is missing. We don't know if she's alive or dead, but we're looking for the survivors now. So Clark Gable, I don't know what, I guess he jumped on a plane himself and he came out here to the closest settlement, which is, well, back down that way. In that valley, there's a little tiny town called Good Springs, and there's an old saloon there. It's actually a really famous saloon because it's supposedly haunted, called the Pioneer Saloon. Well, Clark Gable went down there and waited at that saloon all night long, waiting for news. I mean, obviously the terrain was much too rough for him to come up here and help out with the search and rescue. And it wouldn't have done any good for him to do that anyways. He would have just gotten in the way. So he just sat at the bar down there drinking and waiting, probably biting his nails and probably feeling pretty bad about his recent actions, I would guess. Well, anyway, sadly, like I said, all 22 passengers perished in the plane crash. And, well, I guess eventually the word got back down to Clark Gable and he went back to Hollywood. But man, the recovery effort, even to get the human remains down from up there, was really difficult. So, gosh, that was in 1942, and it's now 2019. So what is that? In the 77 years since the crash, I think there's been a number of people that have hiked up and scavenged stuff from the crash site. But there's supposedly still a pretty decent amount of wreckage up there, just because the crash site, not only is it really difficult to drive up to the trailhead, the hike is supposed to be pretty gnarly too. I mean, it's about 2.2 miles uphill. I think we're gaining almost 2,000 feet in elevation, and there's some pretty sketchy climbing along these cliffs. So it's not a hike for the faint of heart, and you know, it keeps all but the most intrepid explorer from the crash site. But even that being said, enough people have hiked up here and scavenged it to where I'm really not expecting to find too much interesting stuff left. Especially not the most interesting of all the artifacts that's said to be up here. Most notably, Carol Lombard's wedding ring was never recovered from this crash site. Okay, the ring that Clark Gable gave to her. I don't know, not to be gross, but I'm not sure if her hand was severed from her body and it flew away, or if the ring was just flung off of her finger or what, but they never recovered the ring. And supposedly, it's still up there to this day. Can you imagine finding that thing? That would be so amazing. I mean, I would never keep it for myself. I mean, it's not mine to keep. I guess if I found the ring, I would try to track down Carol Lombard's heirs and return it to them. But it would just be an amazing thing to find. I'm not expecting to find it, though. I'm just here for the beautiful fall weather. It's a gorgeous November day. It's November 17th. The weather's just perfect. Not too hot, not too cold. Get a little fresh air, a little exercise, and learn a little history and share it with you guys. This should be an amazing hike because it's a beautiful location, got a great destination, and there's a fascinating backstory. And like I said, I've been wanting to do this hike for a long time. I mean, I've been to the Pioneer Saloon in Good Springs. In fact, I made a video there talking a little bit about this whole plane crash. So I've been there and I've seen all the articles and the memorabilia related to the crash, but I've never actually hiked to the crash site. So I'm really excited to be out here with Larry today. Larry's a good hiker and he's a good navigator. We downloaded really detailed directions how to get here. There's this really cool hiking website called Las Vegas Bird and Hike.com. I got to give a big shout out to that guy because, boy, he details every step of the way on this trail with photos and directions and GPS waypoints. An invaluable resource if you want to attempt this hike. Now, there's actually two ways to access this crash site. You can hike in from the top, or you can come in from the bottom, like us. Now, the downside to coming the way we did is you got to drive that rough, rocky road, which even if you have a 4x4 with high clearance, it's rough. But the upside is, well, if you hike from above, you have to go up a 5-mile gravel utility road all the way to the top. It's a utility road for the people who service that cell phone tower. And I think it's 5 miles long at a pretty steep incline. So you hike 5 miles up to the top and then you come down the face to the crash site. I think the crash site is like right there in that little gully, I think. So we decided to try it from below because I actually tried it once before from on top and it really didn't go so well. That was kind of an interesting story. I went with this guy that I used to go exploring with. Like, we weren't dating, we were just adventure buddies. But at that time, he had a very difficult personality. He was hard to get along with. So he invited me to go up and camp at the top of Mount Potosi with him one night in March. This was probably about 5 years ago. And I was like, yeah, I want to go camp at the top of Mount Potosi. Why not? I want to hike to that plane crash. I mean, remember, I've been wanting to do this hike for a long time. So he goes, okay, well, it's a 5-mile hike up this road and blah, blah, blah. And we have to backpack all our gear. I don't think you can do it. He had a real negative, nasty attitude from the get-go. I don't know why this guy was my friend, but I was like, I can do it, no problem. So I strapped my gear on my back, and we did. We hiked the 5 miles, it wasn't that hard, up to the tippy top there, and we camped out overnight. We actually had a fairly pleasant night. It's amazing views up there. If you ever want to camp someplace cool, you can see the entire area from up there. You can see all the way to Death Valley on one side, Vegas the other. I think you can even see all the way to Lake Mead. Pretty cool place. And then in the morning, we got up, packed up camp, and decided to hike down to the plane crash site on our way back down. Well, it's a long and complicated story, but coming down from the top, especially when you're carrying a bunch of backpacking gear, and I didn't have a real backpack, I just had a knapsack with a bunch of stuff tied to it, like my sleeping roll. It wasn't a very well-secured load. Well, it was really hard coming down because it's very steep and very slippery. It's a lot of loose scree up there. So we got separated. He just clambered on down ahead of me, and I put my pack down and tried going at it on foot, but then I lost sight of him. I couldn't find him, and I didn't think it was really safe to be scrambling down a steep hillside. I don't know. Long story short, I went back up top to get my pack and just hike down and wait for him at the bottom, and my sleeping bag was missing. It was the weirdest thing. I had my sleeping bag rolled up and strapped to the top of my pack, and it was gone. So my first thought was, oh, well, maybe it fell off and rolled down the hill. Well, it was a bright blue sleeping bag against this color of a landscape. It would stand out. I didn't see it anywhere. So then I thought, well, maybe an animal dragged it off. I don't know why an animal would drag off my sleeping bag and not the food that I had in my pack. So that didn't seem very likely. My third thought was, maybe he was messing with me. He was that kind of guy. Like, maybe he stole my sleeping bag and he's messing with me. So I spent a lot of time yelling for him, looking for him, trying to find my sleeping bag. Well, it was March. I mean, there wasn't that much daylight left. I just felt like, well, it was a cheap Walmart sleeping bag. I'm just going to hike back down to the base of the trailhead to my truck. We took my truck, and I'll wait for him there. But man, it took forever for him to show up. And I started to get really worried. Like, what if he fell and hurt himself? Oh, like I said, it was a long story. I got really worried. He had left his cell phone in the car. So I was able to use his cell phone to call his mom and dad and go, hey, your son is missing. Is this something he typically does? And his mom, of course, I talked to her first and she got all worried. Oh, I don't know. I hope he's okay. Well, then his dad got on the line and was like, yeah, he does this kind of thing all the time. Oh, okay. So right then, as I was talking to his dad, there came the guy hiking down the trail. Doo-doo-doo, cool as a cucumber. What happened? Ah! To this day, I hold a grudge against that guy for doing that to me. Anyway, I don't mean to burden you with my personal baggage, but just to say that I have tried this hike once before from above, and it didn't go so well. So I'm here with my friend Larry, who is much more even-tempered and would never abandon me like that. And we're going to try this hike from below. So It's already 1 p.m. We have 4 hours of daylight, so we better get going because it's 2.5 miles up and it's supposed to be kind of a gnarly hike. Hopefully, I make it there and I can show you guys what it looks like. And even more hopefully, I find the wedding ring and I can show you guys that. Okay, from that cabin, we actually were able to drive another mile or so farther up the road. And when I say road, I'm using the term very generously. It was gnarly. I guess on the website that I'm using, the Bird and Hike website, I think he wrote that blog post in like 2011. And at that time, the road was closed off with boulders, or the Forest Service had closed it. Well, there was no closure today. There were no boulders, there were no signs, anything saying it's closed. Whoa! So I just kept on driving as far as I could make it. And we finally came to a point where it seemed like it would be pointless to continue driving. Because I think from here, we do have to get off on foot. Look at this. So here's the road. You can see how rough and rocky it is. And it continues on through this wash or gully and up over there. But right in the middle of the wash, there's a cairn. So it leads me to think we're supposed to hike right up this wash because that's going to take us. Apologies. The sun is right where I need to shoot, of course. But the crash site is right below the sun. So we decided to leave the car parked up there and just hike the rest of this on foot. But altogether, I think we just shaved off something like a mile of the hike. So from here, it's only like, I don't know, maybe a little over a mile, maybe a mile and a half to the crash site. Now, a lot of it's going to be treacherous. According to the website, it's class 2 scrambling, which isn't really that bad. If you watched the video I made climbing White Pinnacle Peak. That was, well, that was class 4 up at the top. It was scary. I didn't really enjoy it. I don't want to do that again, but I think there are a couple parts of this hike that are class 4, so. But for the most part, right now, we're just hiking up a wash. You know what I mean? Like, this isn't too bad. Just your average kind of mountainous wash terrain. So as long as the trail continues to be like this, it's not too bad. And we should have plenty of daylight left. It's already like 1:30 now. It gets dark around, well, it gets dark at 5. So I'd like to be back down that rough road. I'd like to start down that road no later than 4. Because the plan is to drive the rest of the way. We're not gonna go back the way we came, which is nice. We're gonna continue along Cottonwood Valley Road all the way to Good Springs. And, well, hopefully celebrate a successful hike with some burgers at the Pioneer Saloon. So, fingers crossed that it all works out. Now, because this is only a, you know, 2-mile hike or whatever it's gonna end up being, I'm only wearing a day pack with, you know, bare minimum essentials. You know, like I got a headlamp in case we do get stuck here after dark. I've got a sweater because it'll be cold once the sun goes down. You know, survival stuff. I have a space blanket, matches. Of course, I've got 2 liters of water, a couple of snacks. And it's interesting because I haven't had time to go grocery shopping lately, so I didn't have any, you know, power bars or anything like that. Thankfully, I got a bunch of MREs, one of my fans sent me. So I was able to grab some snacks out of the MREs. They're in my pack too. Gosh, I mean, even though I'm just hiking up a wash and I haven't gotten to the cliff part yet, you can still see how like impenetrable this would be, even on horseback, for the people who are up here trying to do the search and rescue. Okay, so thankfully the sun finally dropped down behind the friggin' ridge, so you can kind of get an idea of what I'm talking about here. We're hiking up this kind of, I guess, gully. And then I think, I don't know, Larry's navigating. I think the plane wreckage is like right up there somewhere. What do you think, Larry? Can we see it? Larry's got the picture pulled up on his cell phone from the guy's website. So we're following the topography exactly.
These two rocks. That big rock there and that rock there.
Oh, okay.
So we're gonna go right between them and then up the hill.
We've been climbing and scraping and bushwhacking our way up this miserable wash. But look in the distance. You can see all of Las Vegas, the Vegas Strip. What a trip, look at that. Ha 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 ha. This hike is way harder than I expected. So even though we're navigating using photos, following this guy's directions, I think we didn't climb quite high enough before we turned off to try to get to the wreckage site. I don't know, dude, but the unfortunate thing is it's 3:15, actually it's probably 3:20. We only have about an hour and a half left of daylight, and we need to go all the way down that gnarly wash and then drive back down that horrible road. So unfortunately, as much as I hate to turn around without completing a job, I think we're gonna have to write this off for now. I mean, I marked the GPS coordinates of the crash site on my Google Maps, and there's 4G here because there's a cell tower right up on top of the hill above us. So the crash site is somewhere on that face there, but we're looking, and I didn't bring binoculars, so I don't see any evidence of a plane crash. And there's supposed to be substantial wreckage left behind, like the engines of a DC-3. You know, I feel like you'd be able to see something, and we don't see anything. So I feel like, unfortunately, we need to go home and do more research on the route, or maybe next time, well, hike all the way up to the top and try coming down from above. That might be easier. All right, so we got back down to the car safely, which is good because, well, Larry hurt his ankle.
I rolled my ankle.
But he's a champ, man. Thankfully, he had a selfie stick to use as a hiking stick. He got down, he made it, but now we're both looking back up at the side of this friggin' mountain face, wondering what we did wrong. I mean, that triangular thing in the middle there, that's the saddle that we were on. We were all the way up there. And I think the crash site's behind that.
Mm-hmm. It is. Just to the left. Can't actually see it from here, but yeah, it's right around that corner there to the left.
So,
we were basically near it, but one level down, I think, is where we were at.
We didn't go high enough.
We didn't go high enough.
Well, I would suggest trying it again tomorrow, but Larry hurt his ankle. Larry, what do you say? Do you want to try this again sometime?
I need to come back here because this mountain hurt my foot.
And I need to come back here because this is the second time I've failed trying to get to this dang plane crash. Remember, the first time I tried from the top, fail. This time I tried from the bottom, fail. Third time's the charm.
Helicopter in.
All right, well, I wasn't planning to have a burger at the Pioneer Saloon unless I successfully made it to the plane crash. I was so friggin' hungry by the time we got back down here that, well, I just couldn't say no. Even a failed expedition deserves a good burger.